So this traveler, lost and weary, wandering far from home, came at last upon your
الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا يوافي نعمه يكافي مزيدا يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك انت كما اثنيت على نفسك فلك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد اذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى تلث الأرض ومن عليها أنت خير وارثين الحمد لله praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى for once again gathering us on a very important topic which is the topic of religion in and of itself in the famous tradition that is related in the Sahih of Imam Muslim that is known as the tradition of Jibril and the hadith of Jibril عليه السلام. Many senses when we can look at the universe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the world that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. From one perspective, the universe is the history of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And from another perspective, which is likewise parallel to that narrative, it's the history of angels in and of themselves. And likewise also we can take another narrative from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation, it's also the history of change also. And all three topics, no doubt, are intertwined. This tradition in and of itself, it revolves around the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And the other central figure inside the tradition is the great Archangel Gabriel, alayhi salam, who is the greatest of the actual celestial beings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. And Gabriel is an angel, a malak. And no doubt that the tradition is important, yet it relates to also our transformation unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially in difficult and very, very turbulent times. And so change is essential. The great Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah ta'ala, yet he made mention of the first sign that you're somebody who's reaching a degree in religion is that you begin to sort of experience angels, he said, ashbah al-malaika, that you begin to have a tangible relationship with the angels, who are beings ultimately that are from beyond the actual veil, the angels are from the world of what's called the Malakut, the actual world of angels or the world of the unseen. And in this tradition, we see the greatest of all of those heavenly beings who's known as Jibril, alayhi salam, oft mentioned inside of the Quran. And in terms of the varying traditions or the various readings of the Quran, there are over 10 different ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quote unquote pronounces the name of this great archangel. And angels, by definition in the Arabic language, they're what you call malak, malak, the plural of which is the word malaika. And malak in the Arabic language, it means power. And these are beings of extreme power. And khuliqu min nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them out of light, light. Qadiruna ala tashakkul, they have an ability to transmute, to change into sort of wondrous, higher forms, higher realities, angels. لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهِ They do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala فِيمَا أَمَرَهُمْ In anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands them وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ And they only do that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded them to do. These are beings of absolute obedience to the Divine subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the ulama radiallahu anhum wardahum and they speak about the nature of angels because they're beings that are made out of light and light ordinarily alludes to that which is sentient, that which is intelligent, like intelligent life form. Okay, and so the ulama radiallahu anhum wardahum, when they speak about the nature of intelligence, then ordinarily we get into the conversation of free will. And so there are many of the ulama radiallahu anhum wardahum who are of the belief that the angels in and of themselves are beings of free will, say that their free will is to do as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, and in profound obedience. The first of them to be created was the archangel Israfil. And that's the first of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's angels who he created, Israfil, who's known as Raphael, alayhi salam. And he has many duties and he's part of the important narrative. And his most important duty is what is the nafkhu sur, is the one, the ushering of the Day of Judgment in and of itself. He's the one who has the horn, the angel of the horn. Another important duty, mashallah, tabarakallah, is that he's hajib Allah. Hajib Allah means he's like the veil of God. Some say the bodyguard of God, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's the angel, the custodian of the Lawh al-Mahfuz, the supreme tablet of destiny, Sayyidina Israfil alayhi salam. Of the third beautiful duties for our central narrative is that he's a teacher of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. In the tradition of the Musnad of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, that the Prophet was taught by the Archangel Israfil for 3 entire years, from the age of 40 to the age of 43. كان يعلمه الكلمة والشيء. In the tradition, used to teach the Prophet the word and the entity, the nature of how words represent the form or the reality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, the relationship between words and meanings, words and entities, words and realities. I was taught to the Prophet ﷺ, just as it was taught to Sayyidina Adam, وَعَلَّمَ Adam al-asma'a kullaha, as Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, that He, Allah, taught Adam the names of everything in their entirety. This is Israfil, great angel, the first of those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. We heard of his greatness, that his head is inside of what? It's at the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the highest part of the universe, and his feet are at the lowest part of the universe in and of itself. In the tradition, it said that Sayyidina Israfil alayhi salam is in a perpetual state of buka, a perpetual state of crying. And he understands what's about to take place. And he's the custodian of the tablet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, yani where, due to the height, the size of Israfil, that the tears of Israfil don't reach earth. And were they to reach earth, then we'd experience the tawfan of Nuh, the flooding of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. We'd experience it in each and every single moment. Hakadha Israfil. After 500 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ushers in the creation of the second greatest of the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's the Archangel Mikael, the second of the what we call the archangels inside of English. And likewise, a great angel, the angel who's responsible for all risk, all provision comes through this archangel. Whether it's physical provision or metaphysical provision, spiritual provision, rational provision, whatever the provision may be, it must connect to that great archangel, Sayyidina Mikael alayhi salam. The third of them is part of the narrative of our discussion today, was Gabriel alayhi salam, who was created 500 years after the great archangel Mikael alayhi salam. And he is the greatest of the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alien voices maybe raised Mikael above Jibreel. That was a difference of opinion in early Islam, but the ulama have settled upon the greatness of this great archangel known as Jibreel alayhi salam, who's the greatest of the archangels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his name tells a lot about the story of Jibreel alayhi salam, because some say the name Jibreel in the hadith of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, Jibreel, yani it's Syriac. It's from one of the ancient Semitic languages that is known as Syriac. Okay, and Syriac is underpinning inside of our religion. I mean, the entire Quran written from beginning to end is in the script of Syriac. That's the script of the Quran, the Arabic script. The Arabs, yani ummiyun, huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasula. He is the one who sent amongst the oral people a rasul, a messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. An oral people, la yaktub wa la yahsub. That they don't write and they don't use numbers, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-Bukhari says, نَحْنُ أُمَّةٌ أُمِّيَّةٌ لَا نَكْتُبْ وَلَا نَحْسُبْ. And we are an oral nation. We do not write and we do not use numbers. We don't use symbols, not letters and not numbers, he says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so the script of the Arabs that we read inside the Kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's from what? The Semitic language of Syriac, which is the language of the angels themselves. And not only is it the language of the angels themselves, it's the language of light. By extension, the language of your soul and my soul. Our soul speaks innately Syriac, the language of Syriac, the soul of the human being. Just like it's the language of the angels in and of themselves. And so we see the great archangels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani Israfil, first created. Mikael, second created. Jibreel, third created. Azrael, fourth created. Those names are Syriac. Il Allah. Il means Allah in the Syriac language. And Jibreel, some say the name Jibreel is Abdullah. Others, Jibreel, Jabar, in the language of the Semites, means subjugating power, subjugating force. The subjugating force of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani Mikael, Ubaidillah. You say Mikael, the name Mikael means the endeared slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Syria. Yani the first of them created, Raphael, Israfil, it means Abdul Rahman, the slave of the All Merciful. And that's one of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him first, because the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inscribed inside of the universe in the hadith al-Bukhari, Rahmati sabaqat ghadabi. In another riwayah, Rahmati ghalabat ghadabi, that my mercy outstrips my wrath. And my mercy vanquishes my wrath, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And the first being Allah ta'ala creates is Rahmatul Mutlaq, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. That's the first being. And from the celestial realm, the Archangel Israfil, who's also Abdul Rahman, a manifestation of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the eel. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us slaves of His, endeared slaves of His, means of His mercy manifesting inside of the universe. Jibreel alayhi salam, the qadiruna ala tashakk of the nature of angels, they can manifest in multiple forms. Beautiful forms. And that's what we see inside of the very tradition that was related on behalf of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. Remember the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, kullu mu'minin wali, that every single believer is a wali, is a saint from a perspective. And this is the good opinion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of how do we rise to a degree where we become yani ibad al-Rahman, true slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we regulate our reality for the sake of the divine. That we rise, soar to the angelic horizon, as they say. Because the human being is a juxtaposition between the angelic world and the world of animals. And we can either become like animals, or even further astray, or we can soar to the angelic horizon, be like angels in and of themselves. And so here the Prophet summons us in this reality, that which is higher. Gabriel alayhi salam, it's not everybody sees angels, and we see in the tradition of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, Umar ibn al-Khattab is going to describe the reality of the manifestation of Gabriel. In another tradition, Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Abdul Rahman ibn Sakhar, the great Imam of the Yemen, that he radiallahu anhu describes the manifestation of Gabriel. But there's an interesting tradition, third of this tradition of Jibreel, which is related to the authority of the young Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who although he was present, he said, we could hear the one who was speaking, but we could see no form. And the ulama, they struggle to have what's called tawafuq. How do we sort of reconcile between an apparent discrepancy here? Because we have Umar ibn Khattab seeing Gabriel. We have Sayyidina Hum, Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, warda, seeing Gabriel. But Abdullah ibn Abbas says, we hear the voice, but we see no form. And so the ulama, radiallahu anhum, warda, they speak of the reality of what's called isti'dad. And to be prepared to see the angelic reality. And angels can be present, but not everybody sees angels. Okay? There's a reality to arriving at a degree, at a maqam, at a station where you're now able to engage the angels in and of themselves. He comes, long tradition, famous tradition, inshallah ta'ala, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. One day whilst we're sitting with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab رضي الله عنه ورضاه says, يعني إذ طلع علينا رجل, إذ طلع علينا رجل. That word إذ in the Arabic language was called فجائية. فجائية means like out of nowhere this man appeared. إذ طلع علينا رجل, a man appears. شديد بياض الثياب, he had extremely white clothes with شديد سواد الشعر, an extremely black hair. حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, he says, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu warda says that he was not from Medina to Munawwara, la yura alayhi athru safar wa la ya'rifu minna ahad, that we did not see any signs of travel upon him. I mean, he wasn't like Badu, A'rab, wasn't from beyond Medina. Wa la ya'rifu minna ahad, but likewise none of us knew who he was. He just appeared out of nowhere. Hatta jala sayyidina nabiyyi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, until he comes and he sits in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fa asnada rukbatayhi ila rukbatayhi wa wada'a kafayhi ala fakhidayhi. So he sits right in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, knee to knee, knees right to the knees of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa wada'a kafayhi ala fakhidayhi, and he places his hands upon the actual thighs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to some ulama, or he places his hands upon his own thighs. فقال, Then he says, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad. And this is going to be the beginning of a very, very interesting exchange between the Prophet ﷺ and the great archangel in and of himself, as it becomes clear at the very end of the tradition that is Gabriel alayhi salam. We can speak about the beginning of the tradition, but in the interest of time, we won't focus upon it, but it relates to adab. Adab, etiquette. And what Gabriel alayhi salam is showing you, the adab of approaching the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sahihi wa sallam. From a perspective, there's nothing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to answer, save that Gabriel already knows the answer. But he understands there's a difference between knowledge of something and taking it from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahihi wa sallam. And that's really important to him, to the adab of Islam. Because when we circumvent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahihi wa sallam, yeah, it just ushers in our own demise in front of the Lord of the world, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything has a source. And the source of salvation and guidance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even for the greatest of all beings in the heavenly realm, Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam. In the tradition inside of a Tabarani by the great Imam of the Tabi'een, whose name is Ka'b al-Ahbar, radiallahu anhu warda, he says between the two eyes of every single angel is the name Muhammad. Right between the two eyes of every single angel. And that's one of the ways you will recognize an angel. Am I seeing angels or not? If you don't see the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam between their two eyes, then maybe it's just an illusion. It's a figment of your own imagination. But if you see his name imprinted upon those two beautiful eyes, and Gabriel alayhi salam has multiple eyes, radiallahu anhu, multiple faces, and multiple tongues, multiple languages, all in symphony at one time, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the archangel Gabriel. I mean, to see it is something different. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa on the first occasion he sees it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa is sent into a swoon, he's placed unconscious by the grandeur, the mysterious grandeur of Gabriel. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his azama, his greatness, he only sees Gabriel twice in his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his true form. And that's twice from amongst 124,000 different engagements with Gabriel. That's the meetings of the Rasul, 124,000 times he engages Gabriel alayhi salam. Say that only on two occasions did he see Gabriel in his true form, i.e. the form in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him. One was at the great cave of Hira, that mysterious cave, the cave of Tawheed, the cave in which the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa Abdul Muttalib worshipped in, the cave in which the great Hanif al-Bukhari, Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, worshipped in, and in opinions is buried in, according to Imam al-Waqidi, is buried inside of Hira, the father of Sa'id ibn Zayd, Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, and the cave in which our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam likewise worshipped in, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, for seven formative, primary and important years of Nubuwwah, from 38 to 45, the Prophet ﷺ is almost exclusively inside of the cave of Hira. And it's inside of that cave the Prophet ﷺ sees the reality of Gabriel in his true form, and he sends the Prophet ﷺ into a swoon unconscious. And the second time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the importance of which Allah ta'ala ensures that it's mentioned inside of the Quran, inside of Surah Al-Najm, when the Prophet ﷺ sees Gabriel in his true form at the Sidratul Muntaha. Siddhatul Muntaha, the barrier of the universe, the end of the universe, of matter and light in and of itself. Hakadha the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On this occasion, Gabriel, mashallah, tabarakallah, he manifests as this pristine and pure individual who's teaching the companions, radiallahu anhum wa radahum, adab with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's going to ask a series of questions. The questions relate to the very nature of the human being in and of himself, and how the religion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahihi wa sallam was sent in order to regulate the very reality of the human being in and of himself. Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala, on our discussion of the issue as I'll move towards wilayah, Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala speaks about the man in his growth towards maturity. And he speaks about varying dimensions of the human being. He speaks about the first dimension, like when we speak about the issue of nafs, hawa, that the ego of the human being, being the first reality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows to mature inside of the human being. That's in the first 7 years. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about the first 7 years, la'ibuhum bi sab'in, and he played with them for seven. But make sure they're the center of that world of play. And then Al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala says the next 7 years is what is the world of anger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows anger inside of the human being, what's called yani quwwat al-ghadab, the faculty of anger to mature inside of the human being. It's at that point when anger is something that is chaotic, they need to be regulated. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Sayyidina Ali, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, adibuhum bi sab'in. Now you've got to discipline them for 7 years, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. And then Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala says, after that point, you have the issue of intellect. Quwwat al-aql. The intelligence of man begins to mature. That's as we reach what we call bulugh, as we study inside of fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence. And it's at that point when somebody's intellect begins to manifest, and in the insan alayatullah, ara'ah mustaghna, as Allah ta'ala says. The human being, look at him. And he wa yatgha. He goes beyond every conceivable boundaries. Why? Because now he has intelligence. Ar-ra'ah istaghna. Don't you see that he deems himself independent? And so that's now, the human being is a being that is out of control. Why? Because his intellect, as well as his what, as well as his anger, is only there to save his ego. Because that's the only faculties that he has. And the first faculty that matured inside of the human being was ego, self-centeredness. And that's the nature of man up until Yawm al-Qiyamah. That's when we're just self-centered, selfish creatures. That's human beings. Okay? And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, in the third sort of part of the trivium of our own rearing and education, what does the Prophet ﷺ say? Khaliluhum bisab'in. And now khaliluhum, be their khalil. Yani be their intimate company for 7 years. You can't discipline, you can't dictate to them, but you can be their friend. The Prophet ﷺ said, what's important, that's 21 years. After 21 comes 22. And Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala says, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unleashes upon the reality of man angels. That's where now human beings now begin to engage angels from the world of the unseen, from where you perceive not. Okay, there's those great and beautiful voices that you begin to hear being stirred inside of your heart, that maybe you interpret as thoughts. That's part of the rums, the symbolic nature of the tradition in and of itself. Because that's at 22, the angel appears inside of you. And just like it was 22 days to the day prior to the death of the Prophet ﷺ, that's Gabriel now standing in front of the Prophet ﷺ inside the tradition at hand. What are the questions of Gabriel? There are going to be 5 questions of Jibreel alayhi salam. And they relate to you, they relate to me, they relate to every single human being, how we regulate our reality, how we become angelic. The human being is a juxtaposition of mind, body and soul. Human being, mind, body and soul. And the nature of the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fitrat Allah, as Allah ta'ala says in Surah Al-Rum, in the chapter of the Europeans. This is the primordial nature of God, the aboriginal nature of God that Allah, God, created man upon. La tabdil, you'll find no alteration in that created reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No alteration. And that's what regulation is about. It's about stilling yourself upon your aboriginal nature, your true nature. And that's what the deen al-fitra, the way of fitra, the aboriginal way, deen al-Islam, that's what it comes to do, to regulate your reality. And so Gabriel alayhi salam asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 5 questions. 3 relate to the regulation of the very reality, the edifice, the bunyan of the human being. He asks about Islam, akhbirni anil Islam. He asks about Iman, akhbirni anil Iman. He asks about Ihsan, akhbirni anil Ihsan. Ma huwa ma hiya, so what's the reality of Iman, of Islam and Ihsan? What's the reality of it? Islam is how we regulate the form, the body of the human being. That's what he's asking. How is the form of man, the body of man, regulated? And so the Prophet speaks about physical acts. He speaks about acts of the tongue, he speaks about acts of the hands, he speaks about acts of the stomach, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with a negation therein, acts of the feet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the reality of prayer. That's the reality of zakah, charity given. That's the reality of fasting. And that's the reality of the hajj to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's the reality of the shahada in the beginning, this witnessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, albeit a profession that you desire one day to witness the divine subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's the regulation of your physical being, so that your physical reality is mutar, in obedience to the Divine subhanahu wa ta'ala? That's the question. And the answer was forthcoming from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَعَجِبْنَا أَنْ يَسَلُهُ وَيُصَدِّقُ. Sayyid Umar ibn Khattab says that we were amazed that he would ask the question and thereby say, صَدَقَتَ, you've spoken the truth. And what type of person asks the question to the Prophet sallallahu, and upon the answering of the Rasul sallallahu, he says, صَدَقَتَ, you've spoken the truth. So we were amazed by that, marveled at that, Sayyid Umar ibn Khattab says. The second question, أَخْبِرْنِي عَلِ iman. Tell me about iman. Which we can translate iman as faith. The nature of faith, it relates to the human intellect. It's the regulation of the human mind. That we see the world properly. Not as we perceive it to be, but as it is in reality. Like our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his beautiful prayer, Allahumma arini haqqa haqqa wa rizuqani tiba'a. Oh Allah, show me reality as reality is. Not as I perceive it to be. Wa rizuqani tiba'a. But give me the ability to follow reality, to embrace reality as well. وَأَرِينِي بَاطِلَ بَاطِلَ. And give me the ability to see falsehood as falsehood really is, not as I perceive it to be. وَرَزُّقَنِي اجْتِنَابَ. And give me the ability to shun it, to avoid it. He used to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his famous prayer. So that's the nature of iman. It's about how do we see reality as reality really is. And as our topic heads towards the age in which we live in, that's the end of the tradition in and of itself, part of the problem of the age is we no longer see reality as reality it really is. And when reality manifests upon the tongue of the Prophet ﷺ, where the food kitab of Allah, the book of Allah Ta'ala, the Quran, or the sunnah to the Rasul ﷺ, we belie it and we deny it. That's how we are with the religion in and of itself. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. And a human being, when he sees gone beyond all conceivable bounds, he renders himself independent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? That's majazi, ala ghayr al-haqiqa in the Arabic language. Like istighna, what they call wasl istif'al, of the meanings of that in the language of the Arabs, is the illusion of what? Of independence. Not the reality of independence. That comes from al-mughni subhanahu wa ta'ala. To those ibad al-mukramun, to those who are in true obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the Prophet ﷺ will explain the realities of Allah, what we can call the six pillars of faith, the reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reality of divine communication. Inna Allah huwa al-mutakallim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, God speaks. And he's been speaking since pre-eternity subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is as he was, and as he is, he also shall be subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's not a moment of what we could call divine silence. Not a moment. The divine, God speaks perpetually, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only issue is whether you hear him or not. And that's why he speaks about Allah, that he speaks about divine speech, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in terms of the kutub, in terms of the meanings of God gathered. That's what the kutub means. It doesn't necessarily mean scripture, book. In original prophecy, the word kataba, in the Arabic language, it means to gather something together. It's one of those unique terms in the Arabic language, 500 terms in the Arabic language. If you take the word and you take its meaning, then you turn the word around, you get the antonym, the opposite meaning. So kataba means to gather, and bataka means to disperse, the exact opposite of it. And so the kutub is the gathering of the meanings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside the divine speech. That goes unto whom? Malaika, angels. These are the ambassadors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the supreme ambassador of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jibreel, Aminul Wahi. He is the custodian of revelation. He communicates not only from Allah ta'ala to his slaves, but likewise from slaves, meaning the prophets themselves or the messengers, but likewise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to every single angel. You know, like Laylatul Qadr, the night of supreme destiny. It's not the night of power as it's erroneously translated. It means the night of supreme destiny, Laylatul Qadr. That's the night of Gabriel, alayhi salam. That's Gabriel. تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ سَلَامٌ هِيَ حَتَّى مَطْلَعِ الْفَجَرِ. Who's the ruh? That's what the names of Gabriel, alayhi salam. The spirit. Multiple names Gabriel has, mashallah, tabarakallah. Ruhul Amin. He's a trustworthy spirit. And Ruhul Qudus. The Holy Spirit, like the Holy Ghost, they say in Christianity. And he is what? A namus. He's the bearer of the secret. Yani, and Musa al-Akbar inside of al-Bukhari wa Raqib al-Nawfal, the bearer of the heavenly secret. He's the Rasul in Surah Al-Taha, the messenger. And so the names of Gabriel, as when Samari says, قَبَطْتُ يَلِي بَصَرْتُ, I saw that which you did not see. وَقَبَطْتُ قَبْدَةً مِنْ أَثَرَ الرَّسُولِ, and I seized some of the traces of the Rasul. Who's the Rasul? Gabriel. Who's Samari? On the riwayah, who is Samari? The Dajjal, the Antichrist, mentioned inside of the Quran, that he saw that which nobody else saw. And what he sees is Gabriel upon horseback in the world of the unseen. And what he notices is that the hoof of Gabriel, every time the hoof of the horse of Gabriel touches earth, it brings dead earth back to life. That's the nature of Gabriel, life, the life bringer, Jibreel alayhi salam. And when he sees that, what does he do? He seizes the dust from the hoof of what? Of the actual horse of Gabriel. That's Surah At-Taha. And then he takes that dust and he forms what's called the golden calf. And then he blows the dust into the golden calf and the calf comes alive. And then Banu Israel, while Moses is upon tour, begin to worship the golden calf. Okay? But it's from the traces of Gabriel alayhi salam, as explained in the vision of Sayyidina Hum, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. This is Jibreel, angel, ambassador, supreme ambassador from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to all of his creations. Like in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it says in al-Bukhari, that when Allah ta'ala speaks, the entire heavenly realm falls unconscious. Entire heavenly realm, the entire malak, yani world of the malak, of the malaika in and of themselves. And then when they come, إِذَا فُزِيَ عَنْهُمْ, it's in the Quran as well as in Sahih al-Bukhari explained, that the Prophet ﷺ says, when they come to, then they say, مَاذَا قَهَلَ رَبُّكُمْ, they say, what did your Lord say? Who are they speaking to? Gabriel, Jibreel alayhi salam. They don't say, مَاذَا قَهَلَ رَبُّكَ, singular. They say, رَبُّكُمْ, plural. Why? تَعْظِيم, reverence. I mean, you are the only one who is able to remain living, the living one, Gabriel, and to embrace the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the first words that Gabriel says in the Quran, as well as the hadith al-Bukhari, qalul haqq, he spoke reality. And then Gabriel, the Prophet says, begins to explain to every single angel, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal to him as it relates to that specific angel in question. That's Laylatul Qadr. That's the night of supreme destiny. We're getting a window into what is taking place inside of the heavenly realm in and of itself. We ask that Allah Ta'ala exposes us to its reality. You don't have to be sort of old in order to experience it. We know in the tradition of Imam An-Nawawi, Yahya Sharaf Adin An-Nawawi Rahimahullah Ta'ala, his father mentioned that when Nawawi was 7 years of age, and he just moved beyond the sphere of what? Of the ego, to quote-unquote the sphere of anger. But this is a different type of child, Imam An-Nawawi Rahimahullah Ta'ala. And he said upon this particular night inside of Ramadan, he began to wake up the entire household, 7-year-old boy. And then when everybody wakes up, he's saying, what has taken place? He's screaming, what has taken place? They're asking, why? Why are you waking us up? He said, all I can see is light descending, light upon light descending. And An-Nawawi Rahimahullah Ta'ala said, his father said, at that point in time, I knew he was witnessing Laylatul Qadr, the descent of angels, all coming down to earth, as in Surah Al-Qadr inside of the Quran. Abdul Ulama Abdullah ibn Abbas says, upon the 27th night in particular, he says it occurs. Radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. Look at it, Ibn Abbas, Tarjuman al-Quran, he says that when you look at Surah Al-Qadr inside of the Quran, it has 30 words. 30 words. Every word for the day of the month of Ramadan. And he shows us in three ways that what is the 27th of Ramadan, or of his opinions. One of them is the word hiya. Salamun hiya. Hiya is the 27th word inside of that surah, which means the 27th of Ramadan. Hiya means Laylatul Qadr, the night of supreme destiny. He says, likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr, the night of supreme destiny. He says, Laylatul Qadr is what? It's 9 letters. It's mentioned 3 times in the surah. 9 times 3, 27. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, giving us indications of when that great what day occurs, that great night occurs. So we may be a people who expose ourselves to higher obedience. Gabriel alayhi salam brings it to whom? The Rasul, the Prophets themselves. It's all from the pillars of faith. And these are things that we should be familiar with in order to ensure that our mind is regulated. yani, understands processes, yani, sensory input, yani, in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires for it to be processed. And so the prophets and the messengers, those who they bring it unto. And then the fifth of them, what do they bring? Like our last discussion, knowledge of the day of judgment. And the fifth of the pillars of Islam. And they five, Bunya al-Islam wa al-Khams, Bunya al-Iman wa al-Khams. Everything's built upon five, the foundation. But then the Prophet mentions the sixth, but he mentioned it in a very different way. He said, wa antu'min. Because he said, antu'min billah, wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rasulihi wa yawm al-akhir. He says, to believe in God, His angels, His revelation, His prophets, and the day of judgment. And to believe. That's what he says again. This infisar, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of what? Destiny. Qadar. Wal qadar. Khairihi wa sharrihi. The good and the bad. Hulwi wa murrihi. Experiential good and experiential bad. Min Allahi ta'ala. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa be exalted. Those two are important in terms of religion. Because what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires for us, we cannot attain save through these important arkan. Okay, these important pillars of the religion. The deen. The very end of the tradition when the Prophet asked Umar ibn Khattab, yani, and who was it? Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab says, Allahu wa Rasulu a'lam. Allah and His Messenger knows best. And the Prophet said, innahu Jibreel, it was Gabriel, atakum yu'allimukum deenakum, who came to teach you your deen. And so the deen has pillars, as arkan. Not two, not three, but four. But the first two are very, very important. They assess. They're the paths we traverse unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by virtue of. What is that? The regulation of the physical and the regulation of the rational, the mind. Both have to be regulated. If they're not regulated, mafi kalam, there's no discussion thereafter. We can't speak about spirituality. We can't speak about it. Yeah, if your physics is not regulated, yeah, you're not in outward obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like you're not exoteric. And if your mind is not in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like you don't see the world and its creator in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires for it to be seen, to be perceived, then khalas, we can't speak about the regulation of the spiritual soul. Because the nature of the physics of man and the intellect of man, they veils for the soul. Veils. And those veils must be regulated, i.e. removed, in order for the soul now to manifest, you to manifest, the true you, the aboriginal you, the true self. And so this is the issue of spirituality. And that's when the third question that the Gabriel levels of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yani akhbirni an al-ihsan. They tell me about ihsan. And ihsan is beauty espoused. Because the nature of the soul in its aboriginal form is that it's beautiful. Beautiful. That's the nature of the soul in and of itself. But that beauty of the soul can only be exposed through what? The removing of these physical and rational veils from the human being in and of itself. Okay? And that's why they say that the issue of Islam, it's musil. It's the means to arrive. They say Iman, faith, is musil, yani isal. It's the means to arrive. These are roads that we traverse, that we soldier upon. But ihsan is wusul. It's arrival. It's not the means. It's arrival in and of itself. Differs radically. And then the Prophet ﷺ begins to speak, ﷺ, and look at his words. And تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ وَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. It's to worship Allah as seeing Allah. And worshipping God as seeing God. And if you cannot see God, then you know that God sees you. Note the beginning of the explanation of the Rasul of the reality of religion was antashhad. It is to see. Shahada is to see that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is the messenger of God. It's not to believe. And it's not to profess. It is to witness that, to see that. That's shahada. That's where this begins, the narrative begins, in the regulation of man. But where does it initially end? And ta'abud Allah ka'annaka tara, to worship God as seeing God. And that's the worship of the siddiqoon, of those people, the veracious. And imin al-nabiyyina wa siddiqina, as Allah Ta'ala says. from the prophets and the veracious, the truthful ones, the saintly ones, the ones who see Allah as worshiping Allah. That's what you call maqam al-mushahada. You call that the station of witnessing the divine reality. If you cannot see Allah, then you know Allah Ta'ala sees you. That's called maqam al-muraqaba. That's called the station of being witnessed. The station of vigilance, that you're in every single moment, you are aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you. It's a lower degree. But for us, mashallah, tabarakallah, we ask Allah ta'ala for wusul, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to arrive. Know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, to this point in the tradition, he's been asked three questions. And in it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he comes with qawa'id, he comes with principles. Because the regulation of the physical, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can speak and speak and speak about how you regulate the physical. But he speaks al-usus, he speaks about foundational realities that we have to have. Five things, okay, what we call the five arkan of the deen, the five pillars of religion. Then when he gets to the issue of faith, the Prophet likewise, he speaks about principles, foundational realities, six of them we've just spoken about. And he could have spoke about more, but he's speaking about the usus, the very foundations of the regulation of the human mind. When it comes to the issue of the spirit, the Prophet speaks about two foundational principles, two. The issue of mashahada and the issue of muraqaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is important from this point onwards is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still speaking in the language of principles, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the fourth question that gave levels of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhbirni ani sa'a. Tell me about the hour, the final moment. The sa'a literally means the final moment when the entire universe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala collapses into oblivion. As explained inside of the Kitab in multiple verses, in the Sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in multiple verses. Here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Yuraqib, the Prophet takes you to a different degree. And there's nobody with confidence who can clearly say what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant by what he said. He just said simply sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the question of Gabriel, mal masulu anha bi'alami min asa'il. Yani, ifham bilwad al-arabi. You got to understand it in accordance to the language of the Arabs. مَلْ مَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. What does it mean? Obviously some of the ulama interpreted it as meaning that like the one who's being asked knows no more than the one who's asking. Meaning we both don't know about the hour. And mashallah, the ulama can bring the dalil from Kitab and Sunnah about khams, five things that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, like in Surah Al-Luqman. Okay, from amongst them sa'a, the hour, the final moment. That's knowledge reserved for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's of other ulama who say that. That's not what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. In the mal mas'ulu anha bi'alama min as-sa'il. Okay? That the one who's being asked about it bi'alama min as-sa'il. Yani bi'ziyada yani a'lama min as-sa'il. The one who's being asked about it knows more than the one who's asking. But the amanah is silence. That's its literal meaning right there. And so you're going to have the ulama who generically going to split into two camps of those who are going to affirm knowledge of the hour for the Prophet and of those who will not affirm knowledge of the hour for the Prophet. Ala kullin, whatever way you look at it, it's not our business. Okay? And our business really is not when the hour is going to fall, but our business is ماذا أعددت لها? What have you prepared for it? That's how the teacher the Sahih al-Bukhari in Muslim. When the A'rabi, the Bedouin, comes into the masjid and he asks the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he's speaking, giving a khutbah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meta sa'a. There's the question, bahriz. When is the hour? When is the final moment? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carried on speaking, yani ignored, quote unquote, the one who's asking the question. Okay? Some of them say it's as if he disliked the question being asked. Kareh, the way they used. It was as if he disliked the very nature of that question in and of itself. And so when the Prophet ﷺ finishes, he said, Aina Sa'il, where's the one who asked the question? Ana ya Rasulullah, here I am, I'm the one who asked the question. Look at the way to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ماذا أعددت لها? What is it that you prepared for the hour? That's the question. Because, يعني, Allah ta'ala alam, but there can be a confidence from a perspective that the hour that most of us are preoccupied with Ata amrullah, yani the affair of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has now come, that reality that we're all sort of preoccupied with, we will not engage in. That's sort of the reality as we sort of move on to the discussion of the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam. The Kubra, the supreme hour, when the entire universe is collapsed and sent into oblivion. We're not going to experience that. They said there wouldn't be tribes of the Arabs who would come unto the Prophet ﷺ, say that this was a question that they'd be preoccupied with. And so they'd ask the Prophet ﷺ, when is the hour? And the Prophet ﷺ would routinely answer to them. Look at his way, he'd look for the youngest person amongst them and say, by the time this one dies, by the time this one dies, the hour will arrive. And the one who's pointing that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is long gone. It's gone. MashaAllah, tabarakallah, rahmatillah. So what then does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mean? He means that we have what's called a sa'atu sughra. We have the minor hour. It's death. That's what you should be preoccupied with. The fact that you will die, and then ماذا أعددت له? What is it that you've prepared for death? And what is it that you've taken forth into the next world? What are the traces, the effects that you've left behind in a good sense inside of the world in and of itself? That's the preoccupation. And then it comes back, it must tie back to the theme, as the Arabi, the Bedouin, says, I haven't prepared a lot of prayer, I haven't prepared a lot of fasting, but there's one thing I do know, أُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, I love Allah and His Messenger. So I prepared that much. And that's why, alhamdulillah, if someone who prepares that much, anta ba'a man ahbabta, you're with the one whom you love. Khalas. That's the purpose of life. Just to be with the one whom you love. You love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your purpose of life is to be with Allah. Wujuhun yawma idhin nadira ila rabbiha nadira. Faces upon that day glowing, gazing at their Lord. That's the purpose of life. And you love the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, purpose of life is to be with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahibi sallam. Ma'iyat al-Rasul. Akaba. The purpose of it. Often in life, we lose sight, quote unquote, of our purpose. And then the world in which we're in, it just creates all of these multiple purposes and that ultimately divert us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Gabriel then asked the fifth and final question, alayhi salam, what is that? أخبرني عن أمراتها. Okay, tell me about its signs. Now that's of concern for us. The signs of the hour in and of itself. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam now speaks in a very profound way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the profundity of the words of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you don't see many of the ulama who have actually brought out the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of the implications of what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is speaking about. I mean, our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam is profound. Yani, I mean, subhanAllah, he's profound. Yani, the more or the closer you get to him, the more profound he becomes and the more bewildered you become at his reality, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Your proximity to him, that's one of the greatest proofs that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his reality is divine and lordly. He has the kiss-word of the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him. Because the closer you get to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more you're increasing ignorance about his reality, about who he is. Just the more bewildered, the more you begin to marvel at that reality, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And it would be sort of yani, a wise decision for us to make that if we were to spend more time in getting to know the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the more you know him, mashallah, the more ignorant you become, but the more beloved he becomes to you. That's Kalam Ali ibn Abi Talib in Tirmidhi. Yani, if you got close to him, ma'rifatan ahabba. If you got close to him out of knowledge, you'd only love him more and more and more. And then, anta, ma'amen, ahbabta. You're with the one whom you love. And now that's wusul in its reality. That's arrival in its reality. So the Prophet ﷺ gives us two words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two statements he gives. Antalidu amatu rabbataha, wa antara al-hufata al-urata al-alata ri'a'asha yatatawaluna fil bunya. Two words in their simplicity, basata, he says, but the profundity of what he's indicating at the level of principle, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, literally, sallallahu alayhi wa, it's when a woman, or you can translate it as a slave woman, gives birth to her mistress or gives birth to her master. Riwayah of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, to a mistress, rabbataha. Riwayah of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, rabbaha. Male and female. So when a woman gives birth to her master or mistress. One. That's principle number one. Principle number two, وَأَنْتَرَى الْحُفَاتَ الْعُرَاتَ الْعَالَةَ الْيَعَشَى. You will see a naked, barefoot, destitute shepherd, يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ. يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ, two meanings. One meaning that relates to his heart, another meaning that relates to his form, or the form, physics. In terms of the heart, يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ, arrogant. How he's arrogant and pompous inside of his home. Arrogance. Okay, the disease that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive. And nobody with an atom's weight of arrogance will enter paradise, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. Full stop. Or yatatawaluna fil bunyan, they compete in the construction of lofty buildings. So most of the shuruh are going to say, what does it mean? Yani, and tell the amateur rabbata. It means, they say, it could be the issue of uquq. Yani, when the mother gives birth to disobedient children. And the reality of the disobedience of the child, in particular towards the mother figure. Because the most central figure inside of Islam is the mother figure, the She is the most central figure. Okay, and disobedience to her in particular is disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked in the Sahih, and who deserves the greatest bir, the greatest righteous or courtesy or good manners from me? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ummuka, your mother. He said, Thumma man, then whom? He said, Ummuka, your mother. Thumma man, ya Rasulullah, then whom? After her. He said, Ummuka, your mother. Thumma man, ya Rasulullah. Abuk, your father. And three times a mother, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa said, then your father. And that's why most of the Imams are upon, radiallahu anhum wardahum, be really careful of what? Disobedience to the mother figure. Be careful of that. Very, very careful. In particular. And so what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa is speaking about in the more literal, simple sense, is when we see the whole aboriginal nature of man turned upside down. Okay? Because innately inside of the human being understands obedience to parents, and in particular, obedience to the mother figure. Now, when that is turned upside down, an alteration has occurred inside of human relationships, then that's a sign of the hour, the Prophet ﷺ said. First, meaning. Okay? The second meaning, يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ, the second thing he spoke about, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that you're going to see people who are aboriginal in nature, poor, destitute, naked herdsmen, okay, naked shepherds, that يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ, that their very kiyana has been altered. What does it mean their kiyana has been altered? That the nature of the shepherd, as the Prophet ﷺ explained, and the nature of poor people, as the Prophet ﷺ explained, and they can manifest their poverty in the fact that they lack clothes and they lack shoes. I mean, this was the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're not talking about in antiquity. In the time of the Rasul, the Prophet would go to Banu al-Ashaira. Everyone know Banu al-Ashaira? You know who they are? Like the great Imam Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. That great Imam, radiallahu anhu wa rda, Banu al-Ashaira. They're from the Yemen, from a place called Zabid. First mosque built in the Yemen is called Messengerﷺ al-Ashaira, inside of the Zabid, built by the Sahaba themselves. A city of Abu Hurairah, city of Adosi, city of radiallahu anhu Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. That tribe, the Ash'ariyun, radiallahu anhu wardahum, they were so poor, they didn't have clothes. When the Prophet would come to their height where they used to live, they'd be in dhikr, naked. When the Prophet would come, they'd all scatter to hide. The Prophet said, why is it you scatter to hide? He said, Ya Rasulullah, we don't have anything to cover our awrah. That's how they were, radiallahu anhu. It's ayyam al-Rasul, ahd al-Rasul, in the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi. I mean, that's how you came out of your mother's womb, right? You didn't come out wearing Armani, did you? Some Gucci. You didn't come out dressed like that, did you? You came out naked, honey, and uncircumcised, barefoot, just as you will be raised. Yawm al-Qiyamah, naked, barefoot, and uncircumcised, the Prophet ﷺ said. That's the aboriginal nature of man. Such a man should fall humble. His nature is that will be humble. But the Prophet is saying, when you see that humility, natural humility, now turning into arrogance, sign your muqyama. Fill bunyan inside of houses. Never mind inside of houses, about houses. Yani, look how man is arrogant over a house. That one day will be kharab. Kharab. You know, Pharaoh? Everyone know Pharaoh, huh? Archetype of arrogance. Tell me, where's his house at? Where's the house of Pharaoh? Where's the house of Haman? Where's the house of Qarun? Where's the house of all of these tyrannical figures in history? Where are they now? I mean, subhanAllah. Huh? You know, once, you know, subhanAllah, look at the deviance of the human being. Sure, delicate. Yani, once we were in Spain, in Alhambra, in the Hamra, and our teacher, Habib Umar ibn Nafil, and the people are just like, subhanAllah. Yani, at the Alhambra. Well, the first thing, I'll give you personal experience here. Yani, first thing we noticed when we walked into the Hamra with Habib Umar, all of the tourists who were there for the Hamra began to focus upon Habib Umar. Yani, you had to see it to be like, I mean, these are like non-Muslims who came to see this quote-unquote wonder of the world, and now they're not looking at this sort of form, bunyan, this building, they're looking at a man. I mean, they're all coming up to this man, wanting photos, wanting to speak to him, wanting to know what he's about. One man as he just walks through and sits in the Alhambra. Ibrah number two. What's the lesson I learned? The second lesson I learned is his commentary upon the Alhambra. Now, people are marveling at this. Where are the people now who built it? They now are the bunyan. They are the houses for worms who are eating through their jesed. Man marvels at buildings. Man should marvel at himself. That's who man should marvel at. A man should marvel at the one who created you, created the self, Jalla Jalalu wa Ta'ala Azamatu. A man should marvel at the prototype of man, Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Alaihi Wasallam, the one who's been sent to us for us to imitate. That's worthy of marveling at. But yatatawaluna fil bunyan, to marvel at a building, how are you going to marvel at that? That's gross deviancy of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam from his way. Look at tradition in the Muslim Ahmed ibn Hanbal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, any building that is above sab'ata adhru'. Look at hadith. Because we don't study these hadith, we just cast them aside. No, they no longer apply to the age in which we live in. We're people of tawwur, of science and progress. And that's also sort of how we are in the age in which we live in. Eh? Forget those hadith, don't apply it to us. We've moved on from the time of the Rasul. And so here the Prophet ﷺ says, any house that is over 7 adhra, you know, 7 adhra is like 3.5 meters roughly. It's stupidity beyond that point. Beyond that point, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu wa radahum. Yani when they Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and Sayyidina Utbah ibn Ghazwan, Imams of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu wa radahum, when they got to Basra and Kufa and they built in the great cities of Basra, he said the first houses that they built were tents. They just lived in tents. The heck out of there. We're just all going to live in tents. Then it says in the tradition that Sariqa, because they're in the land of the Ajam, they're not Rubbi'a ala Tarbiya, they don't know Tarbiya. So, thuggery, thievery is widespread. So when you live in a tent, easy access to your house. And so people began to steal from the houses of the companions themselves. So they write to Umar ibn Khattab. They say, we got a problem inside of Basra and Kufa. People are stealing from our tents. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, jawwazahum biqasab. He says, Tayyib, you can build houses out of reed, bamboo. Tayyib, you can have a house out of bamboo. I'll let you have that much. Look how yamshi Umar ibn Khattab, out of bamboo. The Prophet ﷺ one time was walking through the streets of Medina to Munawwara and he sees one of the companions building a house out of bamboo. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? The affair is too dire for that. You ain't got no time to build no house out of no bamboo. No time for that. What we sort of want is to think about the things that are positive inside of our age. Like issues like mortgages or what have you. How some people are now come to a conclusion that a house is min dururiyat in Islam. To own a house is from the sort of necessities of religion. Such that a dururat biha al mahdurat. That necessity makes the impermissible permissible, so now riba is halal. Yani, where have we arrived at when that is a fatwa? Not that people embrace yastur, that manifests upon the tongue of somebody who claims he's a person of knowledge. Kaif? I am stuck for words. I really am. How we can arrive at that type of point. And the Prophet is telling those affairs to die for that. No sooner as you built it, khalas, you dead, you better go and get a house in the corner of the mosque. That's why Abu Hamid al-Ghazali says, that where should you live? In the corner of the masjid. Until you get married, yani, it's going to be difficult with the wife, yani, the corner of the masjid, and when the kids come along. So Ghazali says, then you can go and get a room, one little room to live in, that you can get that. Look at the greats of our religion. Look at the Rasul himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, the house of the Rasul, one room. Yani, Aisha's house is a room, the Hujarat. Salama's house is a room, one room. Some of us maybe studied in the land of Tareem, go to the house of Imam al-Haddad. A room, one room, that's their houses. These are the ones we say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the ones we say, radiallahu anhum. These are the ones we say, rahimahullah. That's what we're speaking about. But here we are, yani khalas, we just, al-ra'ahu istaghna. We've got a different definition, right? We know better. Yeah, we know better. That's what we're saying. Affairs to die for that. So when they build the houses of Qasab, what happens? Fires. And bamboo burns easily. So now, and in those days, yani, you cook with fire. Raftum, it's dangerous. Yani, Fakir, I was in the desert in Mauritania, I learned that. And you cook with coal, fire. So we cooked and cooked with coal. Went to pray my Salah al-Dhuhr. So I'm praying Salah al-Dhuhr. And then and in the masjid of Marabat al-Hajj, and then the entire mosque empties. People begin to scatter in the mosque. That in Mauritania, in the Sahara Desert, usually means a deadly snake. Run for dear life. That's what they do. When the snake comes, you run first, check with it, and then you come back to kill. So when they run, I run. I just ran with them. I was running. Then I noticed, it's not about the snake, because they're not tearing them back. I said, where are you running to? They said, fire. So get the fire. So we're all running towards the fire. I'm like, wow, fire, fire, run. I said, but that's close to my tent. Oh my God, it is my tent. That's my tent. The whole thing burnt down. Yani, subhanAllah. That was one of the greatest durus in my life. Dunya. That's the nature of dunya. Right. SubhanAllah. That's how it goes. Up in smoke. The entire dunya. Right in front of your very eyes. That's how we'll see when we die. We see our entire dunya. As far as we're concerned, go up in smoke as we enter into the barzakh. That was a supreme durus inside of my life. Don't attach to anything inside of this world, because come may it be, you're going to be severed from it, detached from it, you're going to leave it. So they have fire now inside of Basra. So what then do they do? Right to Umar ibn Khattab. The Qasab thing ain't waking, yani. Fires, fires, fires. So Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhum warda, jawwazahum bimadar. He gave them permission now to use mud, adobe. وَإِلَى ثَلَاثِ إِلَى سَبْعَةِ أَذْرُعُ. Not beyond seven أذْرُعُ, seven arms length. 3.5 meters, no house higher than that. In the tradition of the Rasul, look at this, this is a scary tradition. A tradition of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that anybody who builds a house beyond 3.5 meters in height, one of the angels from the heavens, a herald from the heavens, calls out, يَا أَفْسَقَ الْفَاسِقِينَ إِلَى أَيْنَ. Oh, the most wretched of the wretched, where are you going with this? This is, think about it, this is Jack and the Beanstalk. I mean, Jack and the Beanstalk is a deep, provocative, and evil narrative. You know, that sort of the wicked giant inside of the sky. Who's the wicked, tyrannical giant? I know that hell is Jack. That's what we should ask. And so now we can take an interpretation of that. Look at the skyscrapers of America. Who built it? Naked, barefoot, destitute shepherds. Herdsmen, cowsmen, they're the ones who built the skyscrapers of America. Go to the lands of the Muslims themselves, what we're concerned with. Who built those skyscrapers? To this day, who's building them? People, if you ask them, how are you when you were 7 years of age? They'll tell you, I used to live in a tent in the desert. Arabi, Bedou. And now they're building the tallest buildings, quote unquote, on the face of planet Earth. Sunnah to men. The sunnah of whom? Not the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Not his sunnah. Now that is base tafsir, base understanding of those two quote-unquote principles. But it takes on a different proportion. The language of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it addresses every type of mind. From the most simplex of minds to the most complex of minds. And that's the most simplex in terms of understanding of the traditions. But the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is speaking about qawaid. First thing we note, two things. And to keep it short and brief, and inshallah ta'ala, I believe in our other sessions, we'll sort of expand upon the issues of the hour in and of itself. But the first principle relates to women. And the second principle relates to men. But the first one is about women. The second, ri'a-shah, is men, shepherds, males. It's masculine. So it's about male and female. And telidu amata rabbata. What the Prophet is speaking about, the principle here is the issue of relationships. Man in and of himself. Okay? Because man comes out of the womb of a woman. Okay? So when the Prophet is speaking about a woman, وسلم, the principle of the Prophet وسلم, here is from the signs of the hour, is the changes that will occur in the primordial relationships of man in and of himself. The relationship of man with his creator. The relationship of man with himself. The relationship of man with his prophet or his prophets. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Relationship of man with his mother. Of man with his father. Of man with his children. Of man, and I mean man masculine. I mean the human being. With his family. Extended family. With his neighbors. With his muhib. Those who love him. With his nid. Those who are like him. With his did, those who oppose him, those who show enmity towards him. But the very nature of human relationships will undergo a radical change. The Prophet ﷺ is speaking about. That's the first principle. That's what he's telling us. Then the second thing the Prophet ﷺ, and that relates to two things in particular. It relates to the belief that man holds, and it relates to the education of man, the tarbiyah of man. That's why he uses, and tell you to amata rabbataha. Rabb is the issue of tarbiyah. Okay, this is belief. The second is what it relates to what? The cone. The changes that will occur inside of the cone. The universe in and of itself. And so when we look at all of the signs, because the Prophet has thousands upon thousands of hadith that speak about the signs of the hour. And they will return back to two realities. Alterations in man and his relationships, and alterations inside of the natural order. Two. And that's what he's speaking about, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. The Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahih wa sallam, three issue of hukum, three. No, when we look at the nature of society, societies in which we're in, that's what we mentioned, that's what they call like, yani, PPE. The three most important degrees, whatever you think, whatever. In terms of like real importance inside of Western hegemony, the three most important degrees are what? PPE. That's what it is. Philosophy, politics, and economics. Those three. And that, as some of the ulama say, that's what the Prophet is referring to here. With the woman, it's the issue of philosophy. Because philosophy relates to your belief, your understanding of relationships, your purpose in life. That's what philosophy is about, understanding your purpose in life. Answering the question, why? That's philosophy. And that's until the amata rabbata. When a woman gives birth to a master or a mistress. And then the issue of what? And tara al-hufat al-urata ala ri'asha yatatawaluna fil bunyan. The issue of the bunyan, the cosmos of man, that is the PE. Not the public enemy. But the PE meaning politics and economics. That are going to be radical changes in the issue of governance, how human beings are governed, and likewise also iqtisad, economy, economics, money. Okay, the stuff that makes the world go round. And so now we can sort of begin to project that reality upon the sa'at of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so in conclusion, we're just going to give sort of yani, base categorizations. And then now, inshallah ta'ala, in question time or in future sessions, then we can maybe home in upon any topics of choice. But from amongst them, first and foremost, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside of the world of politics, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remember, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spoken about everything. Unbelievable, huh? Everything. Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn Yaman testified to that. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab testified to that. Sayyidina Hudhayfa once said that the Prophet ﷺ has told me everything that will occur from the moment that the universe came into creation up until the very end, till man enters paradise and man enters hell. Everything he told me, radiallahu anhu warda. And he told others who were present, Hudhayfa ibn Yaman says. Rabbi Hudhayfa is like a reflection of Gabriel upon earth. Just as Gabriel is the holder of the heavenly secret, Hudhayfa is the holder of the prophetic secret. That's what he's called. Sahib al-Sir, the holder of the prophetic secret. Hudhayfa ibn Yaman, radiallahu anhu warda. He then mentioned those who remembered, remembered, and those who forgot, forgot. And I too sometimes forget, he said. But he said it's like a long lost friend who has traveled. And then khalas, out of sight, out of mind. And then the day when he returns back, so and so, I haven't seen you in ages. He said the nature of events as they unfold inside of my life, he said, radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. That there's events that the Prophet told me about this, told me about this, told me about this, told me about this, and things he forgot until they occurred. And he also told me about this, saying that Hudhayfa ibn Yaman says. He said, there's not a single tribulation that will happen up until the day of judgment, save that I know what it is. And I know who causes it. I know him by name. I know him by father's name. I know him by tribe, Hudhayfa ibn Yaman says. The profundity of the knowledge that he took from Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And so when we look at the issue of the hour, and the issue of the signs of the hour in and of itself, we can divide them into sort of three types, from two different perspectives, okay? We can divide them into what some of the ulama radiallahu anhum warda, they call the signs of the hour that relate to the life and times of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. And so in the life and times of the Rasul himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are signs of the impending hour. That's the first. That's in Surah An-Nazi'at, يَسَلُونَكَ عَلِ السَّاعَةِ. They ask you about the hour. And then, أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا. When will it anchor itself? When is it going to happen? What does Allah Ta'ala say? فِيمَا أَنْتَ مِنْ ذِكْرَاهَا. You are from the mentionings, i.e. the signs of it. And you are the greatest sign of the impending hour. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi said. And so he himself and his life and times, signs upon signs upon signs that people need to be aware of. The second of them are signs that relate to anything before the life and times of the Prophet ﷺ. Araftum, yani once the clock starts ticking, every tock is a sign of the hour. It's like the hourglass. Once you turn it over, khalas, it's just all tending towards emptiness. Amma. Once again, as he called it, sallallahu alayhi. And so the Quran is full of those signs. So many of us, we hear people want to discuss the issue of the Antichrist. The Antichrist is ancient. And often we speak about the Antichrist as if he's to come. He's long been the Antichrist. That's an ancient sign. It's a sign before the manifestation of the Prophet ﷺ inside of the physical realm. Note that. Okay? And so there are signs that are before the manifestation of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many of them say the first sign of the hour is Cain killing Abel. There inside of the Quran, inside of Ma'idah, Surah Al-Ma'idah in and of itself. And then the third type of signs are what they call the signs that are from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life up until the actual end, the very end of his life sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Three categories. I'm just giving you the categories because it's points of investigation. It gives you sort of a paradigm by virtue of which you could begin to investigate and understand it at a greater, profound level. Because for real, the khidmah that has been done for Islam, and the khidmah that has been done for Iman, and the khidmah, service that has been done for Ihsan, has not been done for the hour. And these would be outward. And even from amongst the Sahaba, that they have a good opinion of people that they see when they worship in the outward, in the Zaman of the Rasul. And so they come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa praising this man Dhul Khuwaysara. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa says, the man who you're speaking about is not as you perceive him to be. Upon his face is the mask of the devil, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa says. No sooner as he says that, the man himself walks in. Not only does he walk into the Rasul, they're outside of the masjid, he walks right past the Rasul, ma sallam ala Rasul. He didn't give salam to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. that ain't necessarily problematic, although it is. The greater problem, the Prophet never gave salams to him. You better than less salam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He defers to give anyone salams. When he don't salam you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, something's wrong, really wrong. Fama salam, sallallahu alayhi. So he enters into the masjid, begins to pray. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at the words of the Rasul, rahmatullahi alameen. He said, khalas, who's going to kill this man? That's the words of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq said, ana, I will, O Messenger of Allah. Qum ya Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr rises, goes into the mosque, khalas. What does Abu Bakr find him? He's standing in prayer, in salah. And Abu Bakr, prayer, azama. And prayer is, the form of prayer is, mashallah. Abu Bakr, he goes back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, inni wajadtuhu yusalli. Oh, Messenger, I found him praying. The Prophet said, man yaqtul hadha rajul. Who's going to kill this man? Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab says, ana, ya Rasulullah. I will, O Messenger of Allah. Qum ya Umar, go. Umar goes into the masjid. Man's in sujood. Umar ibn al-Khattab, sujood. Aqrab al-abd ila rabbihi wa huwa sajid. The closest a slave is to his Lord is when he's in a state of prostration. Umar ibn al-Khattab is taken by sujood. Returns back. Ya Rasulullah, wajadtu yusalli. I found him praying. And the Prophet says, man, yaqtul hadha rajul. Who's going to kill this man? Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib said, ana, I will, O Messenger of Allah. I will. Qama Sayyidina Ali. Kalam Allah. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib stands, goes into the masjid, khalas. Mashaq, the man's gone. Sayyidina Ali returns back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kalam Allah hawajahu, ya Rasulullah, ma wajadtu. I didn't find him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, min hadha rajul, from this man. Yani, people will fly out of the religion. In the same way that an arrow flies right through its target, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I mean, they hit Islam, but they go out the other end. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. In another riwayah, this Dhul Khwaisra comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sitting with his companions. The Prophet is giving out wealth. And he comes, the Prophet gives him wealth. And he says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, i'dil, be just, O Muhammad. What you've just given me is something that you don't desire God by. I mean, subhanAllah. You're accusing the Rasul of insincerity here. You just give me something, but you're not sincere. This is not for Allah Ta'ala's sake. Then this is just for your nafs. Sure, O Dhul Khawaisara. If it was for his nafs, it's still for Allah. That's the nafs of Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. تكلم ما تتكلم به. Speak whatever you want to speak. But show for the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ghadib, he gets angry. In Bukhari, when he gets angry for himself. إِن لَمْ أَعْدِلْ فَمَنْ. If I'm not just, then who? Mean I am justice. That's who I am. Sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he goes. And the rest is history. At the Battle of Yamama, another of the great turnings of the Sukhra, is Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Anhu when he commands Khalid Walid, when they go to Musaylim and the people of the Najd and Tamim, those people. When they go to engage them, Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Anhu, Abu Bakr said to Khalid Walid, don't leave a single man alive. Kill every single one of them, Abu Bakr al-Anhu Wardar says. And Khalid Walid, for reasons, didn't carry out the command of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. For reasons, we can study that in history. But that's an important turning point in history. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, who goes to battle against him. Yet Dhul Khawaisra, same man, at Siffin, great turnings and event, the Battle of Siffin. Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu warda, at the end of the battle, when the battle's over, yani when they vanquish, they ask Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, is this the end of them? Have we finished with these people who are causing schisms inside the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib says, la, we've not finished with them. We will not be finished with them till the last of them will fight in the army of the Antichrist. That's what he said. And so from our muhimma, from our, what's important about us, menhum, who are they? To go even further, look what Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib does. He sends Abdullah ibn Ja'f. He sends Sayyidina Hassan, his son Sayyidina Hassan, go and find Dhul Khawaisra. I want to make sure he's dead on the battlefield at Siffin. They go, they come, Abdullah ibn Ja'f can't find him. Turn over every single body. I want to know, has he been killed? On the battlefield, they there find him killed, Dhul Khawaisra. His problems, khas, he's already sold him in the heart of other people. But they find Dhul Khawaisar bring Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, he says, Khalas. And I bear witness that this man was killed upon the commandment of the Prophet ﷺ. And then 800 people of the Shajara, they say, 800 of the elite of the companions said, we bear witness too. 800 bore witness. And why is that so important? The death of one person, but he dies what? It's like 28-9 years after prophecy. It's the end of Khilafat al-Rashida. And the problems have already been solved. And so the Prophet ﷺ then speaks of Maluk al-Adud. We're going into conclusion now, and then we can take it up another class. Maluk al-Adud relates to the dynasties of Islam. And that starts with Banu Umayyah in a 93-year rule. What's called the Umayyads, the jihad state. From the first of them to the last of them, two different dawlas. Okay? He spoke about them. And we should understand the reality of Maluk al-Adud. They're going to be deposed by the Abbasids. Okay? Both of them are Quraysh. Remember the Prophet ﷺ al-Bukhari? That my ummah will be sent astray by Ghilman min al-Quraysh. Or Ghulayman min al-Quraysh. Or Ghilmat min al-Quraysh. Traditions in al-Bukhari. Of these sort of lads from Quraysh. These immature people from Quraysh. Note, in the hadith in al-Bukhari, the ulama say, yani the rawi of the sahaba said, Ahsabuhum Banu Umayyah. I believe it's the Banu Umayyah the Prophet is speaking about. But it's not only Banu Umayyah as history dictates. And what comes after Banu Umayyah, who's Banu al-Abbas, the Abbasids. And the Abbasids, who they claim to power, is Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet ﷺ. It doesn't go right with the Abbasids. It doesn't go right with them. And to the point that great imams of the religion are going to be tortured for it, from the likes of Imam Malik ibn Anas, the likes of Imam Abu Hanifa, radiallahu anhu warda, the likes of Sayyidina Ahmed ibn Hanbal, imams, likes of Sayyidina Imam al-Shafi'i, radiallahu ta'ala an. Imams are going to be taken to account from the religion for quote-unquote plotting coup d'etat, many of them, to bring them down. Okay? That's what happens with them, the Abbasids. And it becomes a darker period for Islam, okay? But it's in that period whenever there's darkness, light manifests. And that's with Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, at the very, towards the end of the war, the period of the Abbasids. The Abbasids are going to become crashing down, because it's still dynasties, but they come crashing down to a different type of dynasty from without Islam. The first of them is the Mughals, the Tatars. When they come and they just sack the world of Islam. Sack it. I mean, we have not to date experienced killings like what occurred during the Tatar, the Mughal rule. In Khatib al-Baghdadi, in his history of Baghdad, he would tell us that Muslims had to live in the earth. Because what was happening on top of the earth was too wretched. They would come in and slaughter everybody, man, woman, child, and just torch the entire citadel. That's how the Mughals did, the Khans. Until look at the nation, the reality of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will? Yani they just transformed into Muslims, the Mughals themselves. So they end up as Muslims. Then what we're going to see in that period also, because it's the breaking up, this is all from the dynasties. The great dynasties are now going to break up into these petty fiefdoms, kingdoms. Yani, what we can call nation-states, city-states, begins to break up. And that's going to be one of the first periods what allows Jerusalem to be taken. That's the Crusades, the age of the Crusades. What comes after that? It's all from the Maluk al-Adud. Then, khalas, what comes is Banu Uthman. Allah Ta'ala places power from beyond the Arabs, from beyond Quraysh, to the Ottomans, the Turks themselves. And it's an opening of Constantinople with Muhammad al-Fatih, that great caliph who the Prophet bore witness to. And then anyone who goes to Istanbul, I mean, they're not blessed places. Sidi Ayyub al-Ansari, blessed to stand there at Sayyid Abu Yulu Ansari. But anyone who stands at Muhammad al-Fatih, then you understand you're standing on a great man. Till Qa'ir, you understand you're standing on a great man. The presence of that great caliph, eh? Who ushers in what's called the Ottomans, Banu Uthman. And then they're going to have, in its real sense, they wrote it. With the fall of Constantinople, as the Prophet ﷺ told us in other great traditions, al-Arab, you will declare war against the Arabs and Allah will grant you victory. You will declare war against the Persians and Allah will grant you victory. You will declare war against Constantinople, against the Turks, and Allah will grant you victory. But look how long, 1492, look how long it took. How many centuries later? ثُمَّ سَتَغْزُونَ الرُّومَ. Then you will declare war against Europe and Allah will grant you victory. Laysa ba'd. That hasn't occurred yet. ثُمَّ سَتَغْزُونَ الْمَسِيحَ الدَّجَّالِ. Then you will declare war against the Antichrist and Allah will grant you victory. And that's the order it's all going to fall, as in the riwayah. So I know that the Rabi says that the Antichrist will not manifest until the fall of Rome. Haqqa, that's true. Okay? That's how it will go down. And so the Turks come into power. What the Turks do, they bring the Ummah of the Islam back together again. That's what the Turks do. Okay, that's what the Ottomans do. But it's still Muluk. It's still father to son, son to grandson. It's still Muluk, it's still dynasties. Okay? But it's in that period of time that one of the final epochs, which we're in the midst of now, begins to be ushered in. And that's in the hadith in conclusion of saying, I'm always saying a conclusion because where do you stop with this topic? With Sayyidina Hun, the Prophet ﷺ, hadith in Abu Dawood of the hadith of Thawban, where the Prophet ﷺ says, "Satada'a alaykum al-umam." The nations of the world will gather, conspire against you. كَمَا تَتَدَعَ الْأَكَلَةُ عَلَى قَصَعَتِهَا. In the same way where hungry diners will ravish a dish. I mean, they're going to rip you to shreds, the Prophet ﷺ says. They asked the Prophet ﷺ, أَمِنْ قِلَّتِنَا يَوْمَ إِذِنْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Are we going to be few in numbers upon that day, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ says, لَا بَلْ أَنْتُمْ كَفِيرٌ. No, you're great in number. وَلَكِنْ كَغُفَاءِ السَّيْلِ. But you're like the froth upon an ocean. That's why many of the ulama call it marhalatul ghufa'iyya. It's going to be the age of ghufa, which is an extended age, the age of ghufa. The Prophet ﷺ says that Allah سَيَخْرِجَنَّ اللَّهُ مِن قُلُوبِ عَدَائِكُمْ الرُّعْبِ. Allah Ta'ala is going to wrench out of the hearts of your enemies any type of fear of you. Any type of dread of you is going to be taken out of the hearts of your enemies by Allah. And remember, that is a radical change. Because Ru'ab is one of the 5-6 elite khasa'is of the Prophet ﷺ and his ummah. He said in hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. When that is taken out of the hearts of quote-unquote non-Muslims, something has radically gone wrong. And that's why it stretches the age of Khufa'iyah, stretches. That age of Ghufa'iyah does not stop until the manifestation of the Mahdi. It's just Mumtad, that age. From the initiation of Muhammad al-Fatih until what? The manifestation of the Mahdi, it's all Ghufa. And we're just descending and descending into a chasm, into an abyss, into absolute chaos. Absolute tefruqa. And the difference and discord. That's where we're descending into. وَلَيَقْذِفَنَّ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ الْوَحْمِ. And Allah will cast into your heart wahm. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ وَحْن يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What is wahn, O Messenger of Allah? Look what he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And put yourself, your iman, your Islam, or your ihsan upon this scale. حُبِّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَهِيَةَ الْمَوْتِ. Love of the world and an aversion to death. That's it. That's the supreme disease of the age of Khufa'iyya. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about fitan. And you can go through the fitan historically. They played themselves out, most of them. In tradition in Abu Dawood. Fitnatul Ahlas, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fitnatul Sarra, sallallahu alayhi. Fitnatul Duhayma, fitnatul Samma wa Bakma wa Amya. Spoke of the different degrees, 5 different degrees he spoke about there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fitnatul Ahlas, here is the Du'amar of the conspiracy, now to take over the Muslim world. And the most fundamental power in that regard was Portugal. Read your history. Yani, what happens with Portugal? What happens with the founding of America? I mean, that state, that which is a flash in human history. I mean, can you imagine most of the cartographers who drew maps? Yani, the vast majority of human maps in history don't have America upon the map. And it was there, but it's not upon the map. Islamic maps, it's not upon. The scenic maps, the Indo maps, none of them put America there. And it appears in history, yani, as an extension of European power, not only an extension of European power, but it's going to go out of history likewise. Yani, postulates, America plays zero role in the end of time. Zero role in the end of time. No role whatsoever. That's postulates. And we're in the midst of it now, so we can't go see the forest with the trees. But it's not about seeing the forest. It's about seeing Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what it's about. You see him, you take the news from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about how it's all going to play out. And you should have confidence at this point because it's all played out perfectly so far. From his hadith, perfectly to this point, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? So the ahlas here is now how do we begin to carve open the Muslim world? Remember, like 1492 is a critical time, isn't it? It's the fall of the Granada. It's 1492. That's it. Yani, ibqaw alayha. Cry like a woman. And after you fail to defend it like a man. That's what the mother told the child when he gives up the keys to the last kingdom of what? Spain, of Muslim Spain, Andalus. Same year, you also see the fall of what? Of Constantinople, the second to last of the great centers of Christendom, falls to Muhammad al-Fatih. Same year, now we all remember that at school, and I wish I hadn't. In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. These are just drill that into you, you're a child. Columbus sailed the ocean blue. And then he discovered people who were already there. Not only were they already there, so we get to the point, they were your people, Muslim. That's who were there. Do we know that? They were Muslims. Read the Chronicles of Columbus. I have found people, what he calls the Caribs, people who are the same as the people back in Spain and Italy and Portugal. Yani, the Iberian Peninsula, the same people, Muslims, that's what we found. Right there. And what did he do? Exterminated them. And he says these people are the most beautiful, welcoming people that in his diaries that I've ever met. Yani. And then in his letter to Ferdinand and Isabella, he says these will be easy people to subjugate. Look at the demonic mind there. And people let you into their house and they, mashallah, tabarakallah, whatever, mukasa, tukasa. And then you just think of subjugating and enslaving and not even that killing. Yani, taking blankets filled with smallpox and exterminating entire populations. That is an entire people being usurped, being exterminated, and we all speak about going to Disneyland. No, something's wrong. And go to the reservations of the original people on the American continent. Drug addicts, alcoholics. Read the book In the Absence of the Sacred. When the last land that these people have not raped is what the Indians have, because of the sanctity of it, In the Absence of the Sacred by Gerrymander. And the Indians ain't giving up land. So you know what they did? He documented the entire thing of how the entire society just decomposed. You know what they did? They simply gave them satellite TV. And he says, within a year, he saw the entire fabric of Indian society break down. The relationships of man with man and man with the cosmos. Saw it all break down. Read the book, 200-page book by Gerrymander, In the Absence of the Sacred. What they did. And as Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, if we don't speak the truth for men, then who will? Yani, the only reason we won't is because we love life. Isn't it? We love the world, that's the only reason. But if you love Allah Ta'ala and His Rasul, قُلِ الْحَقُّ وَلَوْ مُرَّ. Speak the truth, regardless of the consequences. Well, yani, what's the worst that can happen? Death. Alhamdulillah. Yani, خَلَاسْ إِلَى الْبَرْزَةِ. Alhamdulillah. I'm rid of this God-forsaken world. That's a happy moment. That should be a happy moment when we go beyond the veil. But that is illegitimate. And this is not just about America, but any land or any people that brings about an illegitimate conquest, khalas, the same, hukum applies. That's justice. Wallahu ala anfusikum. Even if it's against yourself, we speak the truth. Wallahu inda sultan al-jahil. Even in front of a tyrannical ruler, when it means your death, you speak the truth. That's deen Allah. That's the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Araft, hakada. After it comes ahlas, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called it harab. Harab, he called that, that's mal al-ahlas. Harab, harab. This is people fleeing for their life. This is issues of war. This is issue of the proliferation of wealth, but wealth means nothing because it's all being usurped. That's the age. And I'm talking about read, the end of 15th century, 16th century. Read those ages. Read the enslavement of people in Africa. Yani, we can go on about 6 million Jews, and we should go on about 6 million Jews. That's an atrocity that Ahlul Islam has to stand up for and stand in defense of the people of Banu Israel. I mean, to kill a life is sacred. What about 6 million people who were killed in the way they were killed? And that is a crime of Europe. They all stood by and allowed it to occur. That's a crime of Europe, what took place with the Jews inside of the gas chambers. In Auschwitz and other places. But then, where's the voice about what happened to the Africans? And if you understood it as Muslims, what happened to the Africans was because of Islam. That's in their chronicles. Because they saw it as the feldspar to the Muslim world. The only way they could come into the Muslim world was from West Africa. That's what they put in their chronicles. And then they could take it from there into the Muslim land. And history she wrote is what okay. That's fitnat al-ahlas. The ahlas is like it's a coat that will be upon man. Then he said a sarrah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's a sarrah? This is after industrial revolution. What begins to appear then? Yeah, the industrialization and the commodification of the human being and the technology and whatever as it leads to. That's what they call the sarrah. And look at the words of the Rasul, the irony of his words. Sarrah here means when people think we're in bliss, we've arrived. Look what technology's done for us. Look what the motor car's done for us. Look at the nature of the plane. Look what this can do. I can even have FaceTime. I can see my long lost cousin on the other side of the earth, and I can say, Salaam Alaikum. Heck, the beauty of technology, the age in which we're fitting to Sarra. But then the Prophet said, Duhayma comes after that, the fitting of the Duhayma. With the Prophet said, there are a single person, illa ratamatuhu. It will slap everybody upside the head, the Prophet said, in Abu Dawud, the Duhayma. And the Duhayma is now when power is effectually being usurped from the Muslim world. Yani, the Sarra is going to usher in colonialism. Duhayma is when they put all the puppet regimes who tyrants in place and they have zero power whatsoever. No power. Qarar, decision making, is in power centers inside of America and power centers inside of Europe. They make decisions on behalf of everybody on the face of planet Earth, even you. That's Duhayma, what the Prophet ﷺ says. And that will just descend into absolute submission. That's what he called Samma Bakma Amya. Blindness, deafness, dumbness, absolute heedlessness. This is where we are at, folks. We're in the midst of that. And light will not come until the manifestation of the Mahdi or those who prepare for the Mahdi, the Mansur, Shu'ayb bin Saleh, and others who come prior to his manifestation. Okay? Tayyip, we ask Allah Ta'ala for tawfiq. And apologies for going on. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammadin wa alayhi wa sallam. The events that are occurring now, the Arab Spring, the turmoil in the Muslim world, was this prophesied in the hadith? And what do the scholars say? How close are the major signs when these events are occurring? The Arab Spring is not a major event. It's not a major event for all intended purposes. Okay? And time plays that out. Okay? That's something that once again comes from the power centers inside of Europe, inside of America, and it went, quote unquote, according to plan, the Arab Spring in and of itself. So there's no reality to that. How close to the signs? Then we gave indications. Imam Asyuti, rahimahullah ta'ala, he has a book called The Kesh, which is the unveiling. And in that book, The Unveiling, he lived in the first millennium of Islam, Imam Asyuti, rahimahullah ta'ala. And in that first millennium of Islam, Imam Asyuti, rahimahullah, he said there was a lot of talk among several of the ulama that the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ is not going to go beyond 1,000 years. So Imam Suyuti writes an entire tract in order to disprove that. That it goes beyond 1,000 years. An entire tract. It's called Al-Kashf. Al-Kashf, the unveiling, the proof that the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, Yujawiz Al-Alf, will go beyond the first millennium. That's what his tract is called. Okay? Imam Suyuti himself dies in the year 931. So he wrote at the beginning of that, the final century of the first millennium. But of the things that he affirms inside of his book, and khalas, radiallahu anhu, his readers make it, the truth will play itself out, if it holds to the truth, is that, but it won't go beyond 1500. That's what he said. It'll go beyond 1,000, but not go beyond 1500. And he brings multiple proofs. But amongst the proof is the simple and very clear tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, my Lord gave me one day. He gave my ummah one day. One day in the language of Quran, Allah and prophecy means 1,000 years. Okay, that's in the Quran. Okay, that a day, a day with your Lord is 1,000 years of your reckoning, as Allah Ta'ala says. Okay, so one day means 1,000 years, that's Quran. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I asked Allah Ta'ala for increase for more than a day. And Allah Ta'ala gave me an additional half a day, like 1,500 days. And that's why we said before, there's not a single scholar yet who's given it a date. And I'm stressing that point, who's given it a date, who's placed it beyond the 15th century of the Muslims. And remember, we are now 1,435. That's where we're at, okay? And if we're about to enter the age of darkness, so here, good question. If we're in the age of darkness, where is absolute submission, and we're in a state of absolute submission to the centers of power in America and Europe, how then should we repent for it? Now, repentance is of the utmost importance. Okay, that we repent for it, and we disconnect from it. Okay, the Prophet in Tirmidhi, he says, "Ma min da'in illa annallahu anzalallahu dawa." There's not a single disease or ailment, say that Allah Ta'ala has also revealed the cure. Okay? So because we're in the age of darkness, it's not submitting to it so that it overcomes us. But also the ilaj, the treatment for those diseases, have also been given by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But a point in question, many of those diseases are too bitter for us to swallow. Because it's an age of radical change, and so it also requires radical change. And that radical change, when people are comfortable with their lifestyles, becomes too difficult. And it will be too difficult for the vast majority of people. Yani, it requires changes that relate to the very reality of Islam. Yani, your physical existence in the world. But that's why the hadith of Gabriel begins with. It requires, and he's prescribed those, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani, it requires things that relate to how you see the world. Okay? The issues of truth and falsehood, good and evil, how you see that. And at the end of the hadith of the Duhayman, the Prophet ﷺ, until people go into Fustatan, they move into two citadels, two camps. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, Fustatul Iman, the camp of faith, la nifaq fi. It has no taint of hypocrisy. Well, Fustat Nifaq or Fustat Kufr, Fustat Kufr, la iman fi. The citadel or the camp of hypocrisy or of disbelief that doesn't have an iota of faith in. That's where we all tend towards. Radically opposed, diametrically opposed camps. That's what the Prophet ﷺ is saying. And so there is a physical ilaj, physical. There's also issues of how we perceive the world, truth, falsehood, good, evil. Spiritual. Okay? And where are you at with the reality of Ihsan? Where are you at with the purification of your soul? Because ultimately, that's only the people of purified souls will be saved in that age. Take one tradition of the Prophet ﷺ, the people of that age. Where is this? This is the Mahdi. When the Mahdi is, there's going to be a Hisar. It's some call it the age of the Antichrist, or the age of the Hisar, with issues of embargo, especially on the forces of good. So the Dajjal is going to surround Jerusalem, and the Mahdi is holding inside of Jerusalem. The Antichrist can't go into Jerusalem. I won't face the forces of the Mahdi. So the forces of the Mahdi are within Jerusalem. Forces of the Antichrist surround Jerusalem. Remember, this is preparing for the descent of Jesus. That's where Jesus is going to descend at the end of that point. Tell you, what does the Prophet say about those people? Starve them out. The Antichrist is saying, just ensure no food, no drink, get them. They'll eventually come out and face us beyond the sacred territory of Jerusalem. What does the Prophet say about those people who were with the Mahdi, alongside the Mahdi? He says, "Qutuhum yawma idhin dhikrullah." Their food upon that day is the remembrance of God. That's how they live. Because they're angelic. The food of angels is the dhikr of Allah. They just need to remember God, and their soul is satiated. And these are spiritual beings. Can you imagine the same people? When they get to Constantinople, Istanbul, and so we understand that Turkey will tend towards Europe, tend towards Kufr. That's what's going to happen with Turkey. Until it enters into Europe. And then it's no longer Istanbul, it returns to Constantinople. That's what's going to happen with Turkey. Khalas, Prophet has spoken about it. When the force of the Mahdi get to there, what did the Prophet say? They're going to take the entire city with dhikr. Just takbir. Allahu Akbar. Allah. They just start making dhikr. The Prophet said half of the city will fall into the ocean. Just through their dhikr. That's a different type of people. That's the people of Ihsan. Everybody else from amongst Ahlul Islam has been vanquished. Who stands in the army of the actual Mahdi of himself. in what's called the Thalatha Malahim. And it's a dire age where people in the name of Islam will be killed, and the Prophet declares them the greatest hypocrites on the face of the earth. And they're fighting alongside the Mahdi. Difficult age. You don't want to live to the age. That's what we're saying there, huh? Tell you. And what is the rank of the Prophet ﷺ in comparison to the highest angels? Is the rank higher? Please explain. The angels at the highest level, they don't compare to the Prophet ﷺ. There's not even a sound comparison. It doesn't exist. Okay? That's important in terms of our worldview. How we understand Allah. How we understand the angel. How we understand the Prophet ﷺ. Laysa lahu mathil. That there is nobody who can be compared with him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not even Gabriel. Okay? And that's one of the greatest statements of bid'ah that the Ummah has ever offered and uttered, is the statement of the Mu'tazila. With the Mu'tazila, believe Gabriel is greater than the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They really made a sort of a drastic mistake there. I don't know how we got it, but maybe this is a sign of the end of time. What's the score with cutting cakes in Rabi'ul Awwal? Is it okay to do? What about all the lights, he says. And what a man's got to do, a man's got to do. That's what I'm saying there. And no time to worry about cakes and lights. And what is your nafs? Your nafs is your ego. That self-centered center inside of man. That's what the nafs is. Questions, I'm going to answer them brief, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but when you get married, what do you need to provide for your wife to be in Islam? You provide your wife with a man. And you mentioned Mikael, and alayhi salam told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some scholars say that no one taught him. So how do we reconcile the views? Was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught by angels alayhi salam or not? We mentioned Israfil, not Mikael. We mentioned Israfil was of the teachers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we go to an original fitrawi understanding of education. And the word education, is a Greek word, it's the word edusere. In Greek. And adusere in Greek means to extract. Okay? So education is the process of extracting. Araftum nazzalahu ala qalbika, as Allah Ta'ala says about Gabriel, the higher of the two. That Allah sent Gabriel down to your heart. At-Tustari rahimahullah Ta'ala says, in order to extract from the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not to put anything in. Okay? And so that should explain the relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the angels. As the hadith explains, does the state of Syria have anything to do with the major signs of Yawm al-Qiyamah? Yani not the major signs, but the minor signs, yeah? What do you mean the minor signs? The signs, or we can call them the wusta, the medial signs, if we split it into three. The signs that are showing us that the major signs are about to occur, about to fall. And what's going on to Syria is very, very important. What's going on in Syria is very important. What's going on in Iraq is very important, just before Syria. That's those two places, in the age of absolute darkness, you have two sub-ages, which are called the age of the Sufyan. The first Sufyani and the second Sufyani that the Prophet spoke about. The first Sufyani, khalas, qad inqadat, finished, that's over, the first Sufyani. We won't go into that here. But the second Sufyani, that is now what's taking place inside of Syria. It's preparing for the manifestation of the Sufyani. The Sufyani is the nemesis of the Mahdi. Okay, it's the hadith in Bukhari, he's going to send the armies down to the Mahdi when he's inside of the Haram of Mecca. That's the Sufyani, the second Sufyani. And the Prophet even told us how long is between the two Sufyanis. How long will transpire until the manifestation of the second Sufyani. What we're seeing in Syria is very important. What we saw in Iraq is very important. What we're seeing now in Egypt is very important. Those three places, very important what's taking place. If that's what we're going to draw from the Arab Spring, then that's a sound conclusion, huh? Is a mortgage haram? Yes. Can the vision of Allah Ta'ala be witnessed inside of this world? Yes. I have a mortgage and pay interest. What should I do? You talked about some scholars allowing mortgages. What is your opinion on the matter? The key about religion, we don't have opinions. That's really key. In our age especially, when it's all about, well, you know, I think, or well, you know, in my opinion, well, I thought about it. And in that age that we live in, no, we don't have opinions. So the issue of mortgages is extremely clear. Extremely clear about mortgages. Sorry, I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news. Because I know, and I've seen it's bearer of bad news. I know, subhanAllah, and look, I mean, mashallah, Allah bless him. I know a person who came into Islam and had a, mashallah, decent-sized house upon mortgage. Soon as he heard that mortgage was haram, khalas, got rid of it. And within a week, khalas, got rid of the entire thing. To this day, he's living in rented accommodation. Okay. Look at Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, a hadith which is central to the end of time, is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that Islam, لَتُنْقَذَنَّ الْإِسْلَامِ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ عُرْوَى عُرْوَى. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that the garb of Islam is going to be stripped button by button. The Prophet ﷺ says, every time a button falls, the next generation holds on to that which comes after it. Okay, and we have sort of no sense of what's gone before. No sense of the Salaf, no sense of the early Khalaf, no sense of that. We're all about the now, like we're reptilian. You see, lower, old mammalian brain that we operate in accordance with. That's what the Prophet is speaking about. Never does a generation come, save that the one that comes after is worse than it, the Prophet has said. Best generation is my generation, then those who come after them, then those who come after them. And then people just get fat. He said in one riwayah, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says it upon the world, he means, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at the traditions. But then, what does it mean? That it's going to be stripped button by button? Look at the Prophet, look at Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab says. It will be stripped button by people who've never tasted jahiliyyah. You see, they're born and raised inside of Islam and they just take this beautiful reality for granted. And they just mess up this beautiful reality. I mean, Islam is Ihsan, it's beautiful. And it's all messed up. Messed up Islam. So sometimes it takes people who are in the midst of jahiliyyah, in the midst of kufr, to come from beyond the citadel of Islam just to shake up the house. And that's talaqi we took from our teacher Habib Umar, Hafizullah. Habib Umar says that there are people in the midst of kufr right now who stand in the ranks of the Mahdi, he said. They're the ones who are going to give victory in the midst of kufr, he said. Look at the Prophet in al-Bukhari. Yani, خيركم في الجاهلية خيركم في الإسلام إذا فقهوا الناس كالمعادن كالذهب والفضة. He said, human beings are like metals, ores, like gold and silver. The best of yous in jahiliyyah, out of Islam, are the best of yous in Islam. إِذَا فَقِهُ. So long as you understand religion. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If someone tells you a hadith or a saying of a sahabi, can you doubt it, even if it goes against another? And Allah, I don't understand the reason to doubt a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Maybe you can doubt the person who's quoting the hadith, but don't necessarily doubt the hadith. Hadith of the Rasul, even if it contradicts. Because contradictions, they can just be issues of zaman, or issues of makan, the deep issue of usul. They can be apparent contradictions, but how do you reconcile? Because they apply to different epochs, like in our discussion. So it's not a contradiction, it's superficial in that sense. So this is the job of the people of usul, and salim al-zimam al-ahliha, they say, deliver the reins to its proper people. And of the signs of the end of time, either wusid al-amal ila ghairi ahli, the Prophet ﷺ says, when this affair is given to the wrong people, that's when the signs of the end of time. Okay? So some of the things we can do to. And so one of the things that we can do to reach and attain ihsan, we better start studying. That's the base of the Islamic reality, it's predicated upon knowledge. And knowledge predicated on sitting in front of teachers. And the teachers you sit in front of are people who have transmission to the Prophet ﷺ. Because walawla al-isnad maqala man sha'a ma sha'a, Abdullah ibn Mubarak and Sahih Muslim said. If it wasn't for that transmission, people would say whatever they wanted to say. My, I, mine, me. If not most, I believe everyone's house is well over 3.5 meters. That's right, in height. Are we sinning by living in our houses? That's what the Prophet ﷺ, when he said about duhayma, it's going to slap everybody in the face. And it's unavoidable. That's what he said, that's what he meant by the age. And the Prophet ﷺ said the age of riba, where everybody will be in riba, or they will be affected by the dust of riba. He said that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I just think there's certain things that are unavoidable. So what is it called? Damage limitation. Okay? Something, it's about, quote unquote, lesser of two evils, damage limitation. And he briefly explained the significance of the Holy Land in end times, the relation of Khurasan, and with the place, and Allah Ta'ala alam, but they protect the places. That's what we're going to, without going into depth about it, is Mecca's protected. It should be Antichrist. Antichrist cannot enter Mecca. Medina to Manawa is protected. Antichrist cannot enter Medina to Manawa, Hadith al-Bukhari and others. And he can't enter into, he has to stay upon the gateways of it. Jerusalem, likewise, he can't enter into the theater of the Holy Land. Okay, so they're protected places. And what that means, are often, because someone asks the question of how do we protect ourselves from the end time scenarios, you can protect yourself through place. Okay? And if you're in the right place, alhamdulillah, that's one of them. Right places are of two types. It's either the Holy Land or it's the Bawadi. Two places. Holy Land, Mecca, Medina, Jerusalem, somebody lives there, you've got a good chance of being saved. Except with Medina to Munawwara. Because Medina, of all times, when it occurs, when Antichrist is right there upon Medina to Munawwara, if you want me to be sort of explicit, right there at King Fahad's palace, which is overlooking Medina University, right there, plus I'm describing the exact place he's going to stand. When he's right there, Medina shakes three times, earthquakes, in Al-Bukhari. And it throws out all of its filth. And illegal citizens will be cast out of Medina's Munawwara, where? Into the hands of the Antichrist. Right into his hands. So it's by and large safe if you're safe here. I remember Islam and Iman, those two words mean what? Safe. That's what the two words mean. Islam and Iman means to be safe. So those realities render you safe, and alhamdulillah, you're a legal citizen of Medina to Munawwara. The third place is where? The countryside. Like see here, Bradford, you can see the hills of Yorkshire. Right there are often the Moors. Moors is Muslims. That's why it's called the Moors. Because that's where those early Muslims, when they were expelled from the Iberian Peninsula, that's where they roamed until Queen Elizabeth I. That's what here we're. She says, there are too many blackamoors inside of the world, inside of the realm. That's what Queen Elizabeth I says, historically. And they've got to do something about this overpopulation of Muslims. And in the age of Queen Elizabeth I, per capita, there was more Muslims than in the reign of Queen Elizabeth II. Per capita, more Muslims. That's why the Moors are the Moors. Okay? So go and live where your folk lived. And you'll be safe from the Antichrist. He doesn't go into the Bawadi. He doesn't go into the countryside, the Antichrist. Okay? And that's in brief. And as for Khorasan, they're the holders of the black flag. And they're the holders of the black flag. The black flag that will come from the Meshrik, the east, that's the people of Khorasan. Khorasan is sort of, if you want to be ayn where Khorasan is, that's its importance, Afghanistan. The epicenter of Khorasan, spoken about by the Prophet ﷺ, is about Afghanistan. They're the Khorasaniyun who the Prophet ﷺ is referring to. And then the most important place is in Khorasan, in Afghanistan, is a place called Taliqan. Look at a place called Taliqan. Possibly even described in the hadith that there are people from Taliqan, يَعْرِفُونَ اللَّهَ حَقَّ الْمَعْرِفَةِ. They have true gnosis of God, Taliqan. Okay? We could interpret it somewhere else in case somebody goes there. There are only two Taliqans upon the face of the earth. And both of them are inside of the greater Khorasan. What are those in modern day nation states? Iran and Afghanistan. We're not going to accept the Taliqan in Iran. We're not going to accept that as Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Okay? But the Taliban inside of Afghanistan as well, is being referred to. So that's the Khurasaniyun. And they're the ones, when you see them, then they're the sign of the Mahdi. The Prophet said, when you see them, not bayruhum, don't give them allegiance. No. He said, bayruhu, give him allegiance. They're the signs of him. Don't get lost in them. The Prophet ﷺ even said, when you see them raise the flags in war, don't even go to their aid. You do not help them until the flags are in the hands of the Mahdi himself. Until you send them, he gives the flags, the standards of the Mahdi, then it's a different matter. Before that, just let them be. Khalas, it's running the course of history. Khalas, let them be, no matter what. And it's scary, the issue of Afghanistan. What we've seen is radical to the loft. We can show you traditions of people who invaded Afghanistan, described by face, by deficiency, by the Prophet ﷺ. Described. And it's frightening what our Prophet ﷺ has said, yani, about these realities. But yani, we're too busy with the Bino, I suppose, than to worry about Nubuwa, prophecy, and what he's saying about the world in which we live in. Tayyip. What do we do, Javed? Otherwise, I think you should go and bring some sahur. Because it's Monday tomorrow, we can all just wait till sahur and... What should we do?
Then we'll leave it for today.
Tayyib, inshallah. Afwan, inshallah. Maybe our next session, we can look at further questions, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullah khairan.